everyone, welcome to homeschool. So we are in the chapter 4th of class 11 biology, that is the animal kingdom. So we have completed 5 phylums, that is Porifera, Coelenterata, Ctenophora, Platyhelminthes and Aschehelminthes. Today we will take up with the next phylum, that is phylum Annelida. So the members belonging to the phylum Annelida, they are majorly aquatic or they can also be terrestrial. So the members can be aquatic, again in the aquatic they can be marine or also they can be freshwater organisms, okay, and they can also be terrestrial, and these organisms can also be free living. So the members of Annelida phylum, so they are usually aquatic. In the aquatic they can either be marine organisms or freshwater organisms, and they also are terrestrial or they can also be free living organisms, and sometimes they can also be parasitic. What is parasitic? Parasitic means the organism is dependent on a living host. They feed on the living host for the survival. Such organisms are called as parasitic. The free living means these are not dependent on or they are not present on a living host. If they are present on a living host, they are called as parasitic. Dead host, they are called as saprophytic. And if they are not dependent on any host, then they are called as the free living organisms. Then moving on to the other characteristics. So they exhibit organ system level of organization. What is organ system level? Too many organs together form one organ system. Okay. So they show or they exhibit organ system level of organization. Then they also exhibit bilateral symmetry. What is bilateral symmetry? When you cut an organism through its main axis and if you open it, then it has to open into equal right and left halves. That is called as the bilateral symmetry. Then these organisms are triploblastic. That is, they originate from 3 germ layers. So, triplo is 3 germ layers, diplo is 2 germ layers. Then, these are coelomates or you can also pronounce it as coelomates or coelomates. And these, the specificity of the members of the Annelida is these are metamerically segmented. So what is this metameric segmentation? So they have very clearly marked segments. They have distinctly marked segments or metamers. The segments are called as metamers, and also these segments are called as annuli, which are also called as annuli. So, since these organisms or the members of Annelida have their body well segmented, and those segments are called as metamers, or also they are also called as annuli. Hence, the members of this particular phylum are being given the name Annelida. Okay, the name Annelida has been given to the members of this phylum. That is because of the presence of the annuli. What are annuli? Annuli are well differentiated or properly marked, clearly marked, distinctly marked segments or metamers are called as the annuli. So the name Annelida has come to the members of this particular phylum. Then, speaking about the body structure or speaking about the skin of the members of the Annelida. Skin, mainly the outermost skin, okay, the outer skin of the members of Annelida, it has got three layers. It has got three layers. So the first layer of the skin is the outer cuticle. We call it as outer cuticle. Second one is epidermis, and third one is the inner layer, outer cuticle, epidermis, and then the inner layer. So specificity of these layers is outer cuticle is mainly made up of the collagen fibers. It is made up of collagen, that is mainly for the stretching. Then the epidermis is a regular epidermis. Then the inner layer or the inner layer, innermost layer of the skin in those three layers. So this is actually muscular in nature. This is muscular in nature, and these muscles, okay, the inner layer muscles show two types of arrangements. The inner layer muscles, they show two types of arrangement, that is longitudinal arrangement and circular arrangement. So one is longitudinal arrangement, so this way, a longitudinal arrangement and then the circular arrangement. We will write it. It is longitudinal arrangement and it is circular arrangement. But however, these muscles usually help in the locomotion. They help in the locomotion. Longitudinal muscles and the circular muscles, they help in the locomotion. So this is about the general characteristics or the external features of the members of the Annelida. So moving on to the internal features. Okay, one more thing here. The skin is usually brown in color in the members of the Annelida, right? All the Annelida members, for example, we have seen the leeches, right? Leeches and usually earthworm. So all are brown in color. So why is that brown? So that brown is mainly due to a presence of a pigment called as porphyrin. Okay. Porphyrin is a pigment. Porphyrin is a pigment which gives that brown color to, or brown shade or the color to the members of the Annelida. Right. So this is about the external features of the members of Annelida. So moving on to the internal characteristics, that is the digestive system, respiratory, excretory, and the nervous system. So here in case of the members of the Annelida, the digestive system is a very well developed digestive system, or in other terms we call it as a complete digestive system. Digestive system is well developed. It is well developed. Then moving on to the respiratory system. So the respiratory system is actually a cutaneous type. We will see what exactly it is. Respiratory system is cutaneous type of respiration, or cutaneous mode of respiration is taking place in the Annelida. So what exactly this means is, here the skin should be moist for the respiration to take place. So or we will write it as moist skin is required. Moist skin is required for the respiration. Hence, a continuous mucus is produced. Hence, continuous mucus is produced on the skin. Fine. So, this is about the respiratory system. Moving on to the excretory system, here the structures called as nephridia are present for the excretion, excretory system, nephridia. Nephridia are the structures which are present for the excretion, and these also help in the osmoregulation. They also help in osmoregulation and excretion. The excretory products are of two types here. One is ammonotelic, other one is ureotelic. One is ammonotelic, other one is ureotelic. So the members which are usually aquatic in nature, these are they excrete the nitrogenous waste in the form of the ammonia, aquatic. And terrestrial members, they usually excrete the nitrogenous waste in the form of the urea, hence they are called as ureotelic. And the aquatic members, wherein they usually excrete the nitrogenous waste in the form of ammonia, are called as the ammonotelic. Fine. And the nephridia are the structures which help in the excretion as well as the osmoregulation. Moving on to the nervous system. So here we have a paired ganglia. Paired ganglia. Right. So ganglia is a plural and ganglion is a singular form of it. So how exactly we can see it is, we have a pharynx here, and on the pharynx we have one ganglion placed, or we have a respiratory structure here. On the respiratory structure there is one particular ganglion present, and one ganglion is present on the ventral, so ventral side and dorsal side. So one each are present, and these ganglions, they are being connected by the nerves or cord like structures. Fine. So the paired ganglia, they are present one each on both the sides, and they are being connected by the nerves. So we call them as the paired ganglia, which are connected by the lateral nerves to a double ventral nerve cord. We have one nerve cord, alright, we have one nerve cord, and so to that particular nerve cord, so it is being connected by the lateral nerves. So one is here at the top, one is here at the bottom, so that is connected by the lateral nerves, and this nerve connection is again going to a ventral nerve cord. Fine. So we will write it anyways. So these are connected by lateral nerves, connected by lateral nerves, and these in turn is connected to a double ventral nerve cord. So a paired ganglion which is connected by the lateral nerves to a double ventral nerve cord. To a double ventral nerve cord. Right, to a double ventral nerve cord. So this is about the nervous system. Then moving on to the reproduction. So reproduction, here we get to see again two different groups of organisms in the annelids. So one is the monoecious. Monoecious, other one is dioecious. Monoecious and the dioecious. So monoecious, so that is here we also call them the members as hermaphrodites. And here hermaphrodites, we have already seen that these are the organisms which carry both female and the male sex organs. So both the organs are present in the same organism or same individual, that is called as a monoecious condition, or it is also called as a hermaphrodite condition. And the best example for the monoecious members of the annelids are earthworm and leeches. earthworm and leech. Leeches are, we also call them as Hirudina. Then dioecious, so here the female and male sex organs are not present in the same individual. They have two different individuals. One is a male individual, one is a female individual. An example for this is the Neris. Neris is a example for the dioecious member. And how about the mode of reproduction? The mode of reproduction anyways is sexual mode of reproduction. They show sexual mode of reproduction. And coming to the development stage, the monoecious members, okay, the monoecious members, these usually show direct development. They show direct development, and the dioecious members, they show indirect development. They show indirect development. So these are a few characteristics or which all most of the members of Annelida usually have these characteristics. So now we will move on to examples. We will just see the structures of those examples. We will take the examples of your NCERT only. One is Neris and other one is Hirudina, otherwise which is also called as the leech. Firstly, we will take the example of the Neris. So, I am just drawing the rough diagrams here. So, we have a body, something like this. Okay, so as we know that they usually have the segmented bodies. We have one first segment is here, and this first most segmented we call it as the mouth. Alright, very first segmented is called as the mouth, and above the mouth we have one segment called as, this is called as prostonium. This is called as prostonium. This prostonium, it has two pairs of eyes. We will draw eyes here. One pair and second pair. So it is two pairs of eyes. Right, two pairs of eyes are present on the prostonium. So then we have some tentacles like structures on the prostonium. We have one at the anterior end and one at the posterior end. So the one which are present here, okay, so these tentacles like structures, these are called as prostomial tentacles. Tentacles, and one more pair, it is present here. It is present here, and these are called as prostomial pulps. One is tentacles and other one is the pulp. Then next, so first segment we had called it as the mouth. The first most segment was called as the mouth. So later on it is segmented like this. It has many segments. These are called as metamers, or otherwise they are also called as annuli. Okay, so since these are also called as annuli, the name Annelida has been given to the members of this phylum. Then, now each and every segment, they have a lateral, they have a pair of structures, or we can also call them as lateral pair of structures called as the parapodia. It is like this. These are somewhat like leaf-like structures. Every segment has it. So all the segments they have this particular structure. So this is parapodia. These are laterally paired structures. Okay, these are laterally paired structures called as parapodia. And these majorly help in the locomotion and respiration. They help in locomotion as well as they help in respiration. Then moving on to the last segment. Okay, so here in the last segment, to the last segment, we have again two structures attached like this, and these are called as the anal cirri. As I said, that the members of Annelida, they have got a complete digestive system. That is, a complete digestive system is it has to have two openings. One is mouth and other one is the anal opening. Only then we call it as a complete digestive system. So this is about the example which is called as Neris. Okay, so we will write it here. This is Neris. Okay, and then second example we will take of the leech. Leech, which is also called as Hirudina. So I think everyone might have seen the leeches and they have experienced the leeches, isn't it? So we get to see one structure like this. At the bottom it is quite bulky here. Okay, it's not too much tapering also. Fine, something like this. And then this is also very well segmented, and the number of segments which are present on the Hirudina is, they have 33 segments. They have 33 segments present on them, and this is called as oral sucker. The specificity or the main feature of the Hirudina or the leech is the presence of the suckers, and they have two sucker. One is an anterior sucker, other one is a posterior sucker. So this is an anterior sucker, otherwise also called as the oral sucker. And here we have one more structure like this, which is also called as the posterior sucker. This is also a segment, and this is called as posterior sucker. Alright, oral sucker or the anterior sucker, and this is the posterior sucker. And how many segments are there? Totally there are 33 segments. And one more very important feature you have to remember here is, so they have a particular anticoagulant present in them, which is called as the Hirudina or Hirudin. Fine. So I'll write it here. Anticoagulant called as Hirudin. See, actually, we all know that leeches, when they get attached to any animal, let's take example of humans only. When they come here, they release some anesthetic agents which are present in them, and due to those anesthetic agents, that particular area will become numb. When the leech gets on our body, we usually don't feel that the leech has come on our body, isn't it? That is mainly because of the agents which it releases and makes that particular region numb. And then when it starts sucking up blood, definitely our vessels will be ruptured, isn't it? Only when our vessels are ruptured, then the blood has to come out. So we also know that when any vessel is ruptured, at that time definitely the blood has to get clotted because of the rushing of the platelets to that particular area. So blood has to clot, isn't it? So that is a regular blood clotting mechanism which is happening in the body. But here what is happening, though it can usually suck more than 10 ml of the blood, that is big, and the blood is not getting clotted here, since the when the particular vessel is ruptured by the leech, definitely the blood has to get coagulated or it has to get clotted. But the leech is releasing few chemicals called as anticoagulant. That is, hirudin is an anticoagulant which is released by the leeches in that particular area, and because of that the blood is not getting clotted and it is in a proper it is showing its proper viscous nature, and it is able to suck the blood successfully. Alright, so it releases anesthetic agents as to make that area numb, as well as it releases the anticoagulant so that the blood should not be clotted at that particular area, and it should be easy for it to suck the blood from an animal. Right, so this is one example for the members of Annelida, and this is the second example, and this is the example Neris. We have written it here, Neris and the leech. Okay, so these are the two examples for the members of Annelida. So I hope you have understood this, and next we will move on to the next phylum, that is the Arthropoda. So the most largest phylum, when you compare it to all other phylums, it is the Arthropoda which is the largest phylum. So we will see what are the characteristics and a few examples for it. As I said, the phylum Arthropoda is the largest phylum. It is the largest phylum. Then, so they also show the organ system level of organization. We will write it. They also show organ system level of organization. Then these are also triploblastic, and they show bilateral symmetry. These are triploblastic in nature, as well as they show bilateral symmetry. Bilateral symmetry, we know what exactly is it. And these are also segmented, and these are coelomates. These are segmented and these are coelomates, or these are coelomates. And then what exactly the word Arthropoda means? The ortho means it is a joint, and poda is appendages. So ortho is, it is joint, poda is appendages. So they have got joint appendages. They have got joint appendages. We will see what exactly is the joint appendages. And then they have an exoskeleton which is usually chitinous in nature. Chitinaceous, or we will write it as exoskeleton. Exoskeleton which is made up of chitin. And what is a chitin? Chitin, what is the nature of the material that is the chitin? It is a homopolysaccharide. It is a homopolysaccharide, that is of N-acetylglucosamine. It has N-acetylglucosamine in it. So it is a homopolysaccharide. Then if you see the small structure for the joint appendages, so how exactly that looks is, so let's imagine we have one particular dorsal structure and one ventral structure. I mean, So arthropoda, let's take an example of crab, or we'll take an example of scorpio only. So we have one dorsal and then we have a ventral structure, and so that particular ventral and dorsal structure, these are being attached by the lateral appendages. So we have one dorsal structure like this, and then one ventral structure like this, and these two are being joined by the lateral appendages. So this the one which is dorsal, it is called as sternum. So dorsal plate is called as the sternum, and the ventral plate is called as the sternum. Ventral plate is called as sternum. Okay, so now these are being attached by the lateral appendages. These are the lateral plates. So now these lateral plates are being attached by the pieces like this. So here, so this lateral one has to get attached to this dorsal plate by the pieces like this. So here we get to see these arthropodal joints, or these are also called as the arthropodal membranes. Okay, these are the membranes, or we can also call it as arthropodal membranes. Okay, so since we have the joints here to join the appendages, the meaning of the joint is the arthro, and appendages is the poda. Hence the name arthropoda has been given to this particular phylum. Then moving on to the specific character of this particular phylum, that is arthropoda, is the presence of the voluntary muscles. Presence of the voluntary muscles. This is very, very important. So we had not seen this particular character in any of the other phylums which we have studied till before. So it is arthropoda which for the first time has got the voluntary muscles henceforth. All right. So this is about the external features or the external characteristics of the members of the arthropoda. Now we will see some few internal characteristics, that is like digestive system and all the other systems. Members of arthropoda, so they show a very well developed digestive system. So hence onwards, we almost see all the well developed digestive system only, because they are all exhibiting the organ system level of the organization. So the digestive system, okay, digestive system is well developed. It is well developed. Then moving on to the respiratory system. So respiratory system here, so this is mainly, they have a tracheal system here. They have a tracheal system, and sometimes they also have gills. They also have gills, like in example of prawns. Okay, like in example of prawns, and sometimes they also have book gills, like in terms of the king crab. Book gills, like example of king crab, and sometimes they also have book lungs. They also have book lungs, like the example of scorpio. Like example of scorpio, fine. Or you can also take the crabs as the normal crabs, or the scorpio for the book lungs. Then moving on to the circulatory system. Circulatory system, they have got open circulatory system. They have open circulatory system. Then about the nervous system. So for the nervous system, we get to see a developed nervous system, that is here. They have a central nervous system. They have a peripheral nervous system. So both are present here. Then moving on to the excretory system. So excretory system here, this is mainly by the presence of the Malpighian tubules. Malpighian tubules. And of course, the excretory products here also are the ammonia as well as urea. Hence, they can be ammonotelic, or they can also be ureotelic. They can be ammonotelic or they can be ureotelic. Then they have one more particular character here or feature here, that is the presence of the sensory organs. So the sensory organs which are present here are the antenna, and eyes are also the sensory organs which are present here, as well as they also have the statocysts. So these are mainly the balancing organs. Statocysts are balancing organs. Alright. The sensory organs here are antenna, eyes, and the statocysts. The statocysts are the balancing organs. Then moving on to the reproductive system, or how exactly the reproduction takes place. So here, usually they have got the separate sexes. Separate, right? These are not hermaphrodites, and the fertilization is usually the internal fertilization. However, the development may be direct or it may be indirect. So here we can also call it as a oviparous development actually. So, oviparous development can be direct or it can be indirect. Fine. So these are few internal characteristics of the members of the Arthropoda. Fine. So we have one more peculiar characteristic here, that is the body structure, or the formation of the body structure. The body structure mainly shows the presence of the head, thorax, as well as the abdomen. So head plus thorax together we call it as a cephalothorax. So the system of the body, or the body structure here, is a cephalothorax. Abdomen body is present in the members of the Arthropoda. So we will take a couple of examples and then we will see how exactly head, thorax, and abdomen is being placed in the members of the Arthropoda. So we will again take the example which is being given in your NCERT only. So that is, we will take prawn as one example, and we will take the scorpio, because anyways most of them, they have the same characteristics. So in the prawn as well as in the scorpio, we get to see the cephalothorax abdomen. We will first write it. The body has got head plus thorax plus abdomen, and head plus thorax we call it as cephalothorax. We call it as cephalothorax. So the body of the structure, a body of the members of the Arthropoda, is usually they have a cephalothorax abdomen. Fine. So we will first take prawn as an example. So I'm just going to draw a rough diagram just to show you the parts of it. So we have a elongated head-like structure first. Okay, so first one, head-like structure is present here. And so this head-like structure, we can take it as the cephalo. Okay, this is the cephalo. and then we have an thorax region and then one abdomen region. So this is the thorax region, and then we have to the thorax region we have the segments attached like this. So totally for a prawn there are usually 6 segments, and we'll first write it, 5th segment and a 6th segment is present like this. So it is quite bent structure here. All right, so now to name the parts of it. So the head structure, head, thorax, and then we have abdomen, right? So now as we have seen, so there should be, and they also have the sensory organs, isn't it? So in the sensory organ we also have the eyes here. So they have got a pair of eyes, a pair of eyes are being present, and we have one more structure in the head that is called as the rose trunk. This particular structure is called as the rose trunk. And then in the thorax region, the thorax region is actually covered by a shield like structure, or we can call it as a very big shield structure, that is the carapace. Okay, the carap here, we will draw it first. A sheet like structure which is present around the thorax is called as carapace, that is the carapace. And then here to in between the attach in between exactly to the attachment of the head and the thorax region, we get to see two pairs of antenna. I'll just draw one to show like this. Okay, so pair of antenna press, two pairs of antenna, one pair on one side, the another pair on another side is present. Fine. Then here to the thorax region, okay, attached to the thorax region, we get to see 5 pairs of walking legs. So walking legs, they are usually present in the pairs. So okay, so here 1 and 2, okay, leg number 1 and leg number 2. So this will make one pair of walking leg. Likewise, we have second pair, third pair, fourth pair and fifth pair. So this is 5 pairs of walking legs. 5 pairs of walking legs are present on the prawn here. Then moving on to the abdomen region. So we have got 6 segments. We have 6 segments here, and every segment there is one paired structure like this. So if this is the segment number 1, we get to see a paired structure like this. Second segment, third segment, then fourth segment, fifth segment, then to the 6th segment, these paired structures are present here, 1 and 2. In between this, we have another elongated structure like this. Fine. So now to name these structures. So these structures which are present here, okay, as a paired structure for the first 5 segments. So these are called as the pleopores. I'll write them here. These are called as pleopores. Okay, so these structures are called as the pleopores, and the one which are present here at the edge to the last segment which are present, so these are usually called as the uropores. These are called as the uropores, and the one which is present here at the center, okay, so this is actually a tail like structure, and this tail like structure is called as the tailsum. This is called as the tailsum, and these pleuropores, they also help in the swimming, as the prawns are usually aquatic in nature. They help the prawns to swim, and these five pairs of legs also, they help in the swimming, or they help in the locomotion. Fine. So this is about the prawn. So we have seen a detailed structure here. Anyways, the head region, thorax region, abdomen region, everything remains the same in the next example, that is Scorpio. Okay, here also everything remains the same, only when it comes to the thorax region. Okay, so head region and everything, that is all same here. So when we come to the thorax region, so here we have segments in the thorax region. Okay, so after the thorax region, we have one abdomen region like this, fine, and then to the, this we call it as the anterior abdomen. I'll write it here. This is anterior abdomen, and then after the anterior abdomen, we have again the segmented body like this, which is called as the posterior abdomen. Quite a long segments these are. Okay, so this is called as the posterior, and to this one stinging structure is present. So this is the posterior abdomen, and to this it has one stinging structure. One stinging structure is present, and this is all the thorax region. This is the thorax region, and then we have the anterior abdomen, and then the posterior abdomen, and then the stinging structure. The only difference which we can say here, when you compare to the prawns, is they have got four pairs of the walking legs. Here we have five pairs of walking legs. So here we only have four pairs of walking legs, as well as these have buklungs. They have buklungs present for the respiration. So we had seen that for the respiration, we have tracheal system, we have gills, we have buklungs, as well as we had buklungs. So among those, the buklungs are present in the Scorpio, and gills are present in the prawns. Okay, in the prawns, gills are present. For the Scorpio, buklungs are present for the respiration. Fine. So this is about the examples for the members of the Arthropoda. So this completes the phylum Arthropoda. I hope you have understood the Annelida as well as the Arthropoda. So you can expect few questions. So what I suggest is you should be very clear with all the namings which I have shown here, because these are like peculiar characteristics which are only present for that particular organism, and they can ask one, they can give the uropods, as well as they can also give the pleopods, and they can ask in which organism it is usually seen. Okay, so you should be very peculiar with all the namings also. Fine. So I hope you have understood these two phylums. So we will stop the class by this, and in the next video we will come up with the remaining phylums. Right. So I'll see you guys in the next class. So till then, keep watching the videos.